Alive in me, and I am free in Jesus. sing cause you are good. I dance cause you are good. I shout cause you are good. You are good to me again. I sing cause you are good. I dance cause you are good. I shout cause you are good. You are good to me. Let's move those feet. Gonna do the bridge.
Cry of praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good, you are good. The sun rays, my life celebrates. You are good, you are good.
The cry. Praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good, you are good. The sun rings, yes we can.
My heart will proclaim. You are good, you are good.
And I sing because you are good. You are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. And I sing because you are good. And I dance because you are good. And I shout because you are good. You are good. You are good to me. Jesus. You are good to me. Praise you, God.
Yes, Father. Yes. Holy Spirit. rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control.
sat down near the collection box in the temple and watched as the crowds dropped in their money. Isn't that kind of funny? There he is, kind of like, I'm going to just plunk myself down here beside the offering box this morning. And the word that the Lord gave me was trust. Last week we were talking about offering as just an opportunity to sow honor. And this week I was reminded of this story, and it's just that sense of when we give, there's that sense of trust. Many rich people put in large amounts. Then a poor widow came and dropped in two small coins. Now, in some contexts, this story is just emphasized that it doesn't matter what you give. Like, Jesus is seeing large amounts and he's seeing small amounts. And then at the same time, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, so Jesus is observing, he says, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has given more than all the others who are making contributions. For they gave a tiny part of their surplus, but she, poor as she is, has given everything she had to live on. And so that whole sense of just, God, when I give my offering, just like that widow, you will supply all my needs. Because from you, that is where they come. And so this morning, we just celebrate when it comes to this opportunity to give as an act of worship with Jesus sitting beside us. That we get to give out of a spirit of God, I trust in. So let's stand and say our offertory prayer. God, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for heaven open, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created, dreams and visions, angelic visitations, declaration, impartation, and divine manifestations, anointings, giftings, and calls, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations, souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revival. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will shower favor, blessings, and increase upon me so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven to see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah and amen. Yes, God. You may be seated. So just a couple of announcements. Can we thank, like, in many ways, the lack of buzz that you hear in the room is because of offerings. So can we, like, celebrate all the work that the tech team has done to put these lights and dim the house and get rid of the white noise? Thank you, Jesus. Selah. So we just say, yay, God, for all the work that's gone into that to just make this more homey. Are you blessed, folks? Yeah. Yay, God. One more time. And again, a special thanks to Trish and Sarah and all their helpers. And I know Jamie spent a ton of time in the nursery. I'd like you to thank them on your way out and stuff like that. But just thank you for the summer ministry that you've offered us all summer long. Can we? And then to kind of kickstart some ministries, just in case you didn't know, this week we started, or this past week on Wednesday night at 8 o'clock until 9 o'clock, or 9:30, depending on how long we chat. But we're trying to do 8 till 9 Wednesday nights. We're doing part of a chunk on trusting in God. It's from the Bethel Foundations series, which is where they're just trying to inspire a love for the Word of God. And so on Wednesday nights, 8 o'clock till 9, we're just doing four sessions. It'll probably be three sessions now because I double booked us on a Wednesday night. So three, if you missed last week, there's only two more. So how many of you like small commitments? So just 2 weeks, and we'll get the beautiful teaching on trusting in God. I left copies of, if you just want your own little Bible study kind of thing, the extra copies that I had made for folk are just at the back table. So if this would encourage you, I just encourage you to pick one up. The topics and their approach to just trusting in God, that in many ways, trusting that God is for you is just such a huge thing. And that's what we looked at, that to really believe He's for you. And so that's what we started on last Wednesday. And the other exciting thing, Mike has agreed for like 3 to 4 weeks to come to Drayton. So Mike Baton and I are hosting Thursday morning, 6 a.m. Six, yeah, that's my evangelist. 6 a.m. 6 a.m. till 7, so that, you know, we did this years ago so that anyone that had kids, you know, you try and get home before everybody wakes up, right? You come. It's kind of like, I don't know about you, but I went to summer camp, and it was like staff devos in the middle of the week where you actually get together, you focus your time on the Lord, we have a little bit of worship, we have a teaching, we pray together, and you go into your work day like blessed. And so, believe it or not, here's my report. More people showed up at 6 a.m. than did 8. So just a special welcome on that. Then the following Wednesday, so I think it's actually, is it 2 weeks from now or next week? 15th? 14th. Is that next week? 2 weeks. Perfect. So then on the 14th, Wednesday the 14th, here, we're going to be hosting Darren Canning. So he's a prophetic fellow from the Ottawa area who has been kind of traveling around the globe, and he was back in the neighborhood. Sharon and Lawrence are kind of hosting him, and so he'll be here on Wednesday night. We'll kind of set up, have an opportunity to kind of worship, pray, give a gift offering, and just hear what God has to say through Darren, who's just a kind of prophetic voice that we're getting to know. And so we just love to encourage folk, if you want to spread the word, September 14th. And then around the 25th, we might be having another, I'm saying Mike because I have to like check it with all my people first, but we have the consultant person coming in after service, and so we're going to try and combine the kind of our typical hot dog lunch so that there will be things for the kids to do, and then the consultant after the service will just kind of give a presentation on the process that they help congregations like ours kind of go through as we dream about future buildings and sites and all that kind of stuff. So is that helpful to get a sense of? Patty, have I missed anything? Ah, yes, I have. Pardon? Oh, time. How many of you know next week is 10:30? 10:30 service next week. Get that extra half hour. Woo, rocking. And then you got... Take a quick moment, look at your chair, and go, thank you, Patty. Yeah, look at your chair, and then look at Patty and say, thank you, Patty. Patty has wonderfully cleaned every single chair in the house for us. So we get to start the fall fresh. Anything else? Missions, we will be coming. I'm hoping we can have someone from Oroville kind of explain and begin to unpack mission signups and all that kind of stuff starting next week. So get ready. We're going to Oroville. All right. Yay, God. Everyone say, yay, God. You ready for a good word from Sathiya? Okay, Sathiya, come on up.
Good morning. Do you got any volume here? Oh, there I am. Oh, Jeff, do you mind just moving that out of the way? Need my space, you know? I'm very territorial up here. Yeah. I need my space. I'm gonna be walking. It's cool. You guys doing okay? Yep. Did you guys have good summers? Can you believe the summer is over already? I know, right? It's not. Oh, some of you are in denial still. Is that? That's usually step one. Oh my goodness. Well, it's good to be here. I just had an unusual summer. I did a lot of traveling. I was in England last week. Yeah. Yeah, you can, all you English people, you can clap for that. Oh, look at this. Look at this. This is, oh my goodness. I should ask you to do stuff for me more often. This is great. That was awesome. Did we catch that on video? I'm sensing a viral clip in the making here. That was great. Thank you. Oh, it's great. I mentioned I was in England. August was just a crazy month. I was in Calgary. One of my close friends was getting married. If I've ever told you a story about praying for people in emergency rooms or, you know, prophesying over people in Clifton Hill, that kind of thing. I did it always with my friend Taylor. He was my partner in crime. And Taylor and I both moved at the same time. So I went to Toronto for school ministry in the fall of 2013, and he moved to BC. And when he moved to BC, his parents moved to Calgary. So they really shifted out west. So it was just a great honor to be there. And the amazing thing at this wedding, you know, I was trying to do the math one day. I'm probably about 40 weddings in the last 4 or 5 years. I had 4 weddings in August alone. So it's just, I don't know, it's just that phase of life. My friends just can't stop getting married. And it's a good thing. It's a really good thing. Taylor is an evangelist at heart, obviously. And so it was really neat the way he designed his wedding. He had asked that the officiant would preach the gospel and do an altar call in the middle of his ceremony. And I was just amazed. Yeah, it was really amazing just to think, wow, like, just to have the presence of mind to incorporate that into a ceremony. And the worship, I've just never experienced worship like that at a wedding. It was really, really amazing. The presence of God was so strong, and everyone from the front to the back was in. You know, they were all worshiping. And we actually found out afterwards, the bride was telling me, whom I don't really know that well before, but she was just telling me, she had a bunch of family there. One of her cousins is a lesbian. Her cousin and her wife were there, and they came up to her and said, you know, the ceremony was really nice, and the worship was amazing. You know, they were impacted by the worship. Another one of her relatives is an uncle, who was abused in the church at a really young age and had not stepped foot in a church since he was 15 years old. And I believe it was about a 30-year gap since he had been in church. That was his first time stepping back, and he said the ceremony was great, but after the worship, he said he was ready to come back to church again. And so it was incredible. It was just incredible to be part of a wedding that had that level of God encounters happening in the midst. So Calgary was cool. My sister came and visited, which is very rare. As some of you even got to see her, you don't understand how rare that is. My sister is just very elusive. She's adventurous, and she hasn't lived near us for years and years. So it was really cool. And then I was in England for, you can probably guess at this point what I was in England for. I was there for more weddings. I was in 2 wedding parties, it was amazing. It was very busy. England is hilarious because it is similar enough that you don't feel like you're really that far away, but it is still different enough that you're very aware you're not in Canada. You know, where there's like, hey, mate, just put your suitcase in the boot. It's like, no, the back of the car, the trunk. Oh, the boot. Like, hey man, I'm thirsty, can I have a glass of water? Water? You mean water? You want water? Where's your bathroom? Oh, what, the loo? I told them I was from Waterloo, they were all confused. Except actually they have Waterloo there. So, you know, pretty much all of our cities in Ontario are named after cities in England, but it was really funny. But really amazing as well. And, you know, people, the obvious question is why? Why would you travel for so many weddings? And the short answer is I just never get sick of watching my friends make covenant. And, you know, it is actually, how often really do you get to watch someone make a covenant before God? And marriage has become this, like, next step in a relationship. But it's not. It is the step. It is the step that you can make between a man and a woman. And covenant is not the next step in a relationship. It is the most sacred form of connection you can have with a person. And I just never get tired of watching my friends make covenant with another person, with the person of their dreams, but also with the Lord. And I just feel like, yeah, how often do you really get to witness that? So I love it. It just never gets old. And, you know, I'm hoping to have a marriage of my own one day. So I will honor the ones before me, before my time comes. So it's been a great summer, and I'm really, really excited to be here and just to gear up and get into the fall. I think it's going to be really, really fun. Before I get into my message, I just, during worship, Larissa, God was highlighting you. Can I ask you to stand up? And I just felt like the Lord wanted me to say that this year ahead for you, it is your year. And you are not going in, you're not going into whatever is next for you as, this is just my next step and whatever. I just feel like God's saying, like, I just see this picture of you getting a hold of the reins, like the reins of a sleigh. And I just feel like God's saying, yeah, this is the time. Go for it. Give all you got. And there are promises. I see, like, this picture of, like, all these things that have been promised to be poured out. Something's been holding them, but I just see it. I see it breaking through, and I just feel like this is a year. It is a year where you're going to see things come full circle, and the things you thought would have happened years ago, they're going to happen. There's a really, really amazing year ahead for you. So can we just stretch our hands to Larissa, and we'll just bless her. Father, we thank you for Larissa. We thank you even just for this stage of life that is upon her. Lord, I ask that you would release divine favor. God, I ask that you would help her to dig her roots deep, and that, God, her faith would be strong through it all. Lord, we thank you that you have lined it all up. God, every little bit of it is lined up by you. And Lord, we just pray that as you go with her, that she is in your blessing, that she is in your care. And we declare that, Larissa, this is your year. This is your year. And that the promises, Lord, the promises that have been delayed or postponed, we call them forth in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Cool. Well, I was on the plane coming back from England. How often do I get to start a message like that? That's just awesome. I was on the plane coming back from England asking the Lord, Lord, what's on your heart? Or what did you want me to speak on? And I kept hearing the same word, and the word was now. Now. And so I'm giving away my punchline right from the get-go. But my message this morning is the time is now. And I've just sensed like there's an urgency that is building in our nation especially, but even just generally speaking, I sense like there's an urgency building, and I just wanted to share a little bit about it this morning. A couple weeks ago, the Healing Rooms in Arthur had their national conference. I kind of alluded to it the Sunday of that weekend. It was a really, really amazing, amazing conference. Very powerful and just awesome to be part of a ministry that is so like-minded and like-hearted. And one of the speakers there was a girl named Crystal Lavallee. She is a friend, someone I've just gone to know over the years. And we had talked about meeting up. She actually did a bunch of my videos for my album when I had released it, 8 or 10 months ago, whenever that was. And we had meant to meet up, and it just didn't work out. So I ended up meeting up with her a couple days later. So we're in Hamilton. We're on the coast, like right by the water. There's a Williams Cafe. It's got a great outdoor spot. So here we are just enjoying a coffee, and the beautiful water's there. There's a roller rink. And oh man, if you want to people watch, just people watch at a roller rink. It is like the best thing ever. People like crawling on their hands and feet. And it's like squirming, trying to get out. It's great. So we're talking, and we're just talking about what God's been doing in our lives. And she's telling me about this great summer she had in BC, and talking a little bit about the conference, and I'm telling her about some of my travels and some of the things God's just been doing in my heart and with music and stuff. And I just hear this, we hear this voice all of a sudden just from the side that says, "Excuse me." And we look over and it's this woman. She's just sitting at a table by herself. And she said, "Excuse me, are you guys Christians?" And we said, yeah, we're Christians. And she said, "Oh my goodness." She said, this afternoon, I felt like the Lord wanted me to come here and journal. And so I'm here and I'm journaling. And then I just hear these two young people, she kept calling us young people, these two young people talking about the Lord. And she said, it was just too good to be true. So we start talking to her and getting to know her. And it was just amazing, just the way God kind of just set it up. And Crystal at one point says, Sathiya, he's actually a pastor, and he's actually going to prophesy over you. And I was like, oh, I am. So I kind of deserve that for all the times I've done that to other people. So I start to prophesy over her and just speak about some of the things I felt like God was saying about her. And she's writing them all down in her journal, and she's like, yeah, that's really true, really true. And I said, actually, and Crystal travels and speaks, and she actually spent the whole morning prophesying over people at a church she was speaking at, so she's like on fire, so she's actually going to give you a prophetic word as well. tit for tat, a little give and take. And so Crystal prophesies over her, and we had a great conversation, a great chat, and it was so easy. You know, we were just at a coffee shop just talking about our lives and talking about what God's been doing. And it just opened the door wide open for her to have an encounter. And these kinds of things have just been, they're happening more frequently, not just in my own life, but I'm hearing stories of other people that are stepping out, other people where things that were difficult or things they felt like they were supposed to do, there was a block, there's an ease coming, and I just sense like the time is now. There's just an urgency that is brewing. And I just need to share about it this morning. And between the conferences and the outpourings, you know, there's been an outpouring going on in Hamilton for since May, I think, so 3 or 4 months now. Between the prophetic words, I mean, was anyone blessed by Jerry's message here a couple of weeks ago? Wasn't that it was just incredible. And if you weren't here, I highly encourage you to go and watch it, because you will get, you'll see how funny God is, how in the 1 week where we have scaffolding in the building, God uses it to prophesy into the destiny of our house. I mean, how crazy is that? But also, Jerry hit on so many things that I think we are called to as a community. It was amazing. And so I'm seeing all these things happen, and I'm just like, ah, yes, the time is now. And we hear prophetic words, and we hear good messages, and we hear about the things that God is going to do. But I just wonder if God is maybe inviting us to be the first ones, where it's like he's made us aware of what he's doing. Now it's time for us to take a step out. When the revival broke out in Toronto in 94, almost immediately prophetic words were starting to come out about the next generation, which was kind of ironic because God was doing so much currently in that space. You know, people were getting delivered and set free and healed, and people are coming to know Jesus, and all these amazing things are happening, and yet the prophetic words that were coming were about the next generation. And it gives us an indicator, actually, as to the heart of God, doesn't it? When he pours something out, his goal is always sustenance, that it would never just be a moment or days, but actually that it would continue for generations. It is the nature of revival. It is meant to be stewarded and carried on. But actually, one of the things that they were prophesied about the next generation is that they would be nameless and faceless, that there would be a rising up of the nameless and faceless people of God. And the first time I ever heard that, I just felt like such a burning in my heart. Like, yes, I will claim that for me, for my own life. Just so we're clear, generation is not it is not a reference to the young people, as my friend Kim said when we were at Williams. It is not the young people. Generationally speaking, when the Lord says generation, it is all who are on the earth right now. We are all part of this generation. And the next generation that was prophesied 20 years ago, 22 years ago, that's us. We are part of that. As long as you're alive, you're part of this generation. And I just I'm gripped. I'm gripped even by the idea of being the nameless and faceless generation, a group of people that will run after God. They don't need their name. They don't need their name anywhere. They're willing to put it aside so that the name of Jesus is glorified. It's the people who they don't need their faces on the posters or the billboards. It might happen, but it's not the goal. The goal is that we are so nameless and faceless. We are so void of ourselves, and actually not even void of ourselves. It's that we're so consumed by God that he is glorified way, way greater beyond anything we could receive as earthly beings. It was amazing to be part of so many different weddings. The four weddings in August, I did worship for all of them, actually. And it was really neat just to see, you know, just to see the different groups and the way people worship and all that kind of stuff. I love after worship set to have people come up and say, you know, the worship was amazing, it was great, and, you know, or that song was great or whatever. I love it. But actually, I'm learning to gain more pleasure in people coming up to me afterwards and just talking about how great the worship set was because of what God did. Where I don't need any acknowledgement. I mean, I was there. You know, I know I was there. So that's okay. I just don't need the acknowledgement because it's we're talking about what God has done and what he's doing. It is that willingness to just lay down and be nameless and faceless. And you and I are all called to that. We are beginning, I believe, the fulfillment of that prophetic word. When I got back from England, I had to jump in a cab from the airport and had to catch the fire. That's where I parked my car. They let me park it there while I was gone, which was very generous of them. So thank you, Catch the Fire, if you're watching this online. Appreciate that. It's just a quick minute. It's like a quick 5-minute drive kind of thing. Traffic was a little bit bad, so like it was 8 minutes. So it's an 8-minute cab drive. The cab drivers dropped me off at the car, and this guy was so nice. He was just really friendly right from the get-go, and so we're talking about London, England, and we're talking about, I don't know, I forget everything we talked about, but it was really easy. And he stops at the car, and I'm opening the door, and I just hear the Lord say, "You need to prophesy over him." And I'm like, you know that little panic you get where it's like, I'm like, God, I have like 3 steps from this door to getting my suitcase at the back, and then I'm gone. And but I heard it, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna do it. So I'm walking back. I'm like trying to slow down I'm like suddenly walking really slowly to the back, like trying to get something. And he's taking the suitcase out of the back, and he hands me my suitcase, and he said, "Do you work here?" And I said, "No. I said I used to go here, but I work with an affiliate church about an hour and a half away from here." And he said, "Oh, that's cool." And I said, "Yeah. You know what? Actually, I said I'm like kind of a pastor, and sometimes God tells me stuff about other people. Do you mind if I share what he was telling me about you?" I had nothing. I had actually nothing. So I kind of lied. So Lord, forgive me. And he said, "Sure." And I start to speak, and as soon as I open my mouth, it's like boom. And the Lord just starts to tell me about his family line, and he had a line of business in his family, and about his destiny, like about the dreams that were kind of stagnant and he had just left alone. And his eyes just kind of lit up, and when I was done, he just said, "No one's ever told me anything like this. Like, what is this?" And it was a beautiful door into one of the things we had talked about in the car was India, because he was Indian, and he was from the northern part, which is heavily Punjab, a kind of branch of religion there. And so I knew the culture that he, you know, was from a little bit. And so when he had told me, "No one has ever told me anything like this," I was able to say, "This is Jesus." And just kind of tell him the gospel in really simple terms, really simple words. And he said, "Wow." He said, is there church here?" He's pointing at the building. I said, "Yeah, there's church here." I said, you should come here." Or I said, "You can come to my church." I said, be happy to have you here. And it's just, I don't know, these things are just becoming so frequent that I just can't ignore the signs. That it is a time, I believe, for us to really pursue God, to really seek him, to... you know, the common analogy is you have one foot in the world and maybe 1 foot in God, and there's that uncertainty. I actually sense like there's many of us that are actually, we're about 3/4 or 90% in God. And I just feel like God is asking us to give that extra 10%, that fullness. It's kind of like, all right, let's take a breath in. Just take a breath in and take a breath out. All right, let's do it again. Take a breath in. Take a breath out. and breathe out again. To see how there's that extra little bit that you didn't really know was there, but it was there. And I just feel like many of us, if not all of us in the room, have given. We've given that breath out. But there's just a little bit more left that I feel like the Lord is asking, will you give it? Will you seek me with that little bit that you have there? If you have your Bibles, you can turn to 2 Chronicles 7. I have a lot of heroes in the Bible. There's a lot of really amazing people in here. There's some obvious ones. Jesus, of course, the Sunday school answer. We love Jesus. But I do really love the life of Jesus, obviously. David is a hero of mine. And David's son, Solomon, has become a real favorite of mine in the Bible just the last few years. Solomon is known best for being the man of wisdom. The Lord appeared to him. If you read earlier in 2 Chronicles, the Lord appeared to him in the night. He said, I will give you whatever you want. You know, you have found favor in my eyes. What do you want? Solomon, he could have asked for fame, fortune, riches. He could have asked for popularity. He could have asked for even just decent things like respect. He could have asked to be, a humble person, anything like that. But the man asked for wisdom. Of all the things in the world he could get from the Lord, the God of the universe, the ultimate provider, he asked for wisdom. Some translations, actually, the word used there says he asked for a listening ear. And if you read the full, in its fullness, it says, he asked for wisdom that he may govern the people well. So he really, at a young age, he was king at this point. And at a young age and early in his career as king, he had a heart for the people. He desired wisdom. So he asked, Lord, give me wisdom that I may, give me the listening ear that I may govern my people well. The Lord gives him wisdom. And the Lord says, because you did not ask for any of those other things, the riches, the wealth, the fame, anything else, you will also get those things. And so Solomon has this encounter with the Lord. He receives an exchange, a deposit, if you will. And where we're about to read now is years later, where Solomon is building or has built the temple. He's rebuilt the temple of the Lord. He's used the plans that his father David had. David was not able to build the temple because his hands had shed blood. So the Lord told him, you need to pass down these plans to Solomon. And in one of the books, I forget which one it is, I think it's Kings, David actually blesses Solomon. He actually blesses Solomon to build the temple. So here we are. And what is happening now is the Lord has appeared to Solomon as they've dedicated the temple. So starting at verse 12 here, the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain or command the locust, or command the locust to devour the land or send pestilence among my people. I meant to give you just a little bit of context just so you understand what's going on here. The first two verses of this chapter, when Solomon finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. The priests could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. So it would be like you trying to walk through those doors and you couldn't. The presence of God, the manifest presence of God, was so thick that they could not enter. So this is a crazy encounter they are having, and it teaches us something actually, because Solomon, in his first encounter, he took the things the Lord gave him. He spent years using them, building them, and ultimately developing a kingdom that was very wealthy, very successful. And then here he is, everything he has used and created has now become. It's become a wineskin for another encounter. Do you see that? So the ultimate product of an encounter is another encounter. It is that whatever the Lord deposits within you in those moments where you encounter him, you steward them well, you're faithful, and you're obedient to the things he calls you to, and then boom, you're set up for a greater encounter. This encounter is significant. There's a presence of God, so much so that people cannot walk in. Verse 14, and this is it. This is like my pinpoint scripture this morning. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Verse 15, now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayer made in this place. Verse 16, for now I have chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. As for you, if you walk before me as your father David walked, we know David was a man after God's own heart, and do according to all that I have commanded you, and if you keep my statutes and judgment, I will establish the throne of your kingdom as I covenanted with David your father, saying, you shall not fail to have a man as ruler in Israel. There's tons in this scripture, but it is those couple verses right in the middle that I think are so important. So I just want to read them one more time, okay? This is verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now, everybody say now. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayer made in this place. For now, everybody say now. Now I have chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. It's a great promise. And the amazing thing is, even in these days where the Lord is saying now, it is still something we can claim for today. That now is the time where the Lord is looking for people and places where he can inhabit. You know, our mission here at Selah is to make people and places come alive and thrive in God's presence. People and places that are so occupied, they're so inhabited, that God is there perpetually, like it says in the scriptures. So God is inviting us. He is inviting us to humbly seek him, to humbly seek him and to discover the good things he has. I felt like it is interesting because I think sometimes the question we ask the most is, God, what are you actually doing? It is the nature of serving an invisible God, is you get bits and pieces, but really, you actually never get the full picture. And so we're left asking, you know, God, what are you doing? Or, God, here's this great promise, but what does that actually mean? What does that really look like? What does it entail? What do I have to do? And I believe that God is asking us to seek him that we may become aware of his activity. And it is amazing how quickly people will seek something else other than God to find out what God is doing. You know, some people I've heard, they will see what the enemy is doing, and based on that, they will then determine what God is doing. And the thinking, actually, I can see how it would be logical. It's, you know, the enemy, of course, is responding. They're in opposition. So if I see what the enemy is doing, I just flip it, and that's what God is doing. The problem is the enemy is always 10 steps behind God. So you'll be 10 steps behind God if you decide what he's doing based on what the enemy is doing. Everything the enemy does is in reaction to God. So you and I, in a time, in any time, in any moment where you need to seek God, where you feel like you want to know his plans, you want to know what does it look like, what does it mean, how do I do it, it is an invitation to seek him. If my people will seek my face, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. And that is the invitation to you this morning. It is to seek him with all that you have, that 90% and then that extra 10% that you didn't even know you had in you. It is that invitation to go after God with all that you have, not to pursue the promise. That's always the temptation, is to pursue the promise or the things that he's given us. And you can be proactive. You should be proactive towards those things. But actually, with our hearts, we are always called to seek him first. In Mark is a great, great, great portion of scripture because it just cuts to the chase. You know, it doesn't waste any time, doesn't mince any words. Mark chapter 1, this is verse 14 and 15 in Mark chapter 1, if you're following me here. Jesus came to Galilee preaching the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled. One might say, the time is now. And the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The time is fulfilled. I'm going to paraphrase and say, the time is now. This is Jesus telling people, the time is now. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. This, we've heard the scripture so many times, but actually this is, it is significant scripture. You have to understand, before Jesus came on the earth, I forget the numbers, but the law of Moses had something like 150, maybe 200 rules, things that they were meant to follow. there was a period, a gap where there were no prophets. There was really no interaction. I think it's 400 years, but I don't quote me on that. But there was a long period of time, and in that time, the religious leaders established another, I believe it's 300 or 400 rules in that time. And we know how it goes with any kind of authority figure. The more rules you have, the more it's like you can't keep track of it. It's distant. The relationship becomes very, I don't know, very static. It becomes a little bit rigid. This is how people are relating to God at this point in time. They know all the rules, but they know him to be distant. And Jesus lives on the earth for 30 years before he's even launched into ministry. For 30 years, he lives on the earth, and he hears people speak incorrectly about God. So Jesus is coming and saying, that kingdom that you think is so distant, that kingdom that you think is so far away that belongs to this God up in the sky, actually, it's near. It's at hand. The word there actually means approaching. It is coming towards. The time is now, and the kingdom of God is at hand. And it's interesting because he ends that by saying, repent. We know that repent means to change your ways, to change your thinking, and believe in the gospel. So Jesus makes them aware of something. He says, you know, everything that you dream of in God, it is available to you. It is within reach. You can touch it. You can feel it. It's there. He says, it is at hand, and now he says, therefore, believe. And it is interesting. I just think those two ideas are so significant, because I think if we knew how within reach the goodness of God was for us, then I think we really would be able to run with it, to run that great race of faith that it talks about in Hebrews. When I was in England, I moved around from city to city, and we had just finished wedding. Wedding number one was done, and the plan was I was going to wake up the next morning, I was going to catch a train and go on to the next city for wedding number two. And the system there works a little bit differently, and I was feeling reasonably confident with it because I had traveled it for a couple days and didn't have any issues. And my friend had told me, he had bought the ticket for me. He said, you got to grab your train at 9:35. So I said, no problem. Set my alarm accordingly. I had it all planned out. And then I opened the ticket, and on the ticket it said 9:59. So I was kind of confused, and I showed it to another fellow British person who I thought surely would understand the ways of the rail. And I showed it to him, and he said, oh yeah, he said, I think we can go at 9:59. Now he had to drive me, so he was probably a little bit biased and wanted to drive me later so he could sleep a bit more. Whatever the reason was, we show up at 9:59, the train was gone. It came at 9:35. It's like, shoot, how did that happen? So the ticket was actually for my changeover, and anyway. But when I showed up at 9, I think I showed up at 9:50. When I showed up at 9:50, I didn't run after the train. It was long gone. It was well beyond reach. It would have been silly to run. But when something is at hand, you know, if that train was just leaving the station, I probably would have made a dash for it. So there's actually something helpful about us knowing that the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is near. It is not out of reach. It is not beyond. And you know, the promises, the goals, the dreams, all the things that you associate with what God is doing and what God is yet to do, all those things are within reach. They are. And he is inviting us to seek him this morning. There, in history, there just seem to be these times, these moments, these, I would call it maybe a window where God makes things available that weren't available before and maybe are not available after. That part I don't really know. But I just know there are these windows that come where God is eager to pour out. You know, when the revival started in Toronto, it was more than anything they could have dreamed of. And a couple weeks in, John Arnott tells this great story of his wife, Carol, is on the stage, and at some point in worship, she gets hit with the Holy Spirit, and she starts manifesting, and not gentle manifesting. She's overcome with the Holy Spirit. She's violent, like in her actions are violent. She is loud. She is like yelling, and totally disruptive to what is going on. So the ushers come to John and they say, "John, we're on it. We're gonna move her. We're gonna get her out of the way." And he says, "No, just wait." And they're kind of looking at him funny, like, "What do you mean, just wait?" And he said, "Just wait. Like, let's just let this play out a little bit." So this goes on for 5 minutes and then 10 minutes, and they're coming back and they're saying, "Do you want us to do something about it?" And he said, "Just wait." 45 minutes later, it is through. Whatever the Lord was doing, it is through. And you know, they carried on, and the evening went as normal, and they continued to have meetings. And a few days later, actually, I don't know the exact timeline, but I just know at some point afterwards, John was talking with the Lord and was saying, "You know, Lord, what was that, and what was that about, and why? Like, why did I?" Like, he was even kind of like, "Why did I let that happen for 45 minutes?" And the Lord said to him, "John, if you would have taken her off, your revival would have lasted 2 weeks." There was just a window. There was something that was being made available, and the Lord was pouring out and then eager to see how he would respond. And to be honest, the revival would have been extremely significant still if it had only lasted 2 more weeks. But aren't we grateful it didn't? Aren't we grateful it went on a little bit longer than that? So sometimes, Jeff and I were talking earlier this week about thin places, and how spiritual people, whether they're Christians or not, they seem to be good at identifying thin places. Thin places is this expression that kind of describes the idea of things seem more readily available spiritually. For us, in our terms, it is like where the gap between heaven and earth is narrow. It is thin. It is that thin place. And I just feel like the Lord is calling us into a thin place. A time where he has all these things that he is just ready to pour out, ready to lavish. And actually, he's not, it's not conditional, it doesn't come with strings attached, but actually what he is looking for is just a response. He's looking for people who will humble themselves, who will seek him. And I don't know if there's anything I can stir in you this morning. It is just, let's seek the Lord together. Let's go after him. Let's give him that extra 10%. Let's tap into the things. Let's believe that the promises that seem impossible, that they are for now. That is the whole premise of faith. Faith needs an impossibility, or it's not faith. You don't need faith to accomplish what is possible. And I just feel it in my spirit, like we are entering a season where the Lord is just eager to release good things on us. And I want us to grab a hold of it. I want to read to you, just as I kind of wrap up here, I want to read to you a couple prophecies that have been spoken about Canada. One of the things I am noticing as I travel to, you know, England or Malaysia or wherever, and even in Western Canada, there is a stirring of God that is happening in our country. We are not alone in our pursuit of God, and that nothing makes me happier than that. Really, God has such good things for our country, and I want to read to you a couple prophecies that have been spoken about Canada over the years. In 1776, just a few short years ago, not at all. 1776, that's like 340 years ago, or 240 years ago. In 1776, when American leaders were about to invade Canada, chase down British loyalists who had turned north to settle in Canada in order to remain under British rule, the Spirit of the Lord spoke through the prophets. Oh, I lost my spot here. Spoke through their prophets and said this: "Do not hinder these people. Let them move to Canada. Do not seek to incorporate the land of Canada into America. I am in the independence of America from Britain and will mightily use this country, but Canada has been reserved by me for the last days for a special work." 240 years ago. Do you guys know who David Yonggi Cho is? David Yonggi Cho pastored one of the biggest, if not the biggest, church in the world in South Korea. He is a brilliant leader and a real man of God. And my mom actually attended his church. She went to visit my sister when she lived there. And she said, like, she wept for most of the service she was there. The presence of God was just so incredible. And so David Yonggi Cho is a really amazing leader. He doesn't travel that much anymore. At one point, though, he was in Canada. And this is what he spoke about Canada in 1975 in Kelowna, BC. When I came to Canada, the Holy Spirit spoke in my heart, "Son, you have come to the place which I chose. This country is the country I chose to fill the gap. Being a Canadian is now a welcome hallmark throughout the world." True. "You have the welcome open door like the Philadelphia church in Revelation. You have finances, well-trained personnel, and a good church. God calls you to rise up to meet this challenge before Christ comes. A clear-cut clarion trumpet sound is coming to Canada. Rise up, Canada. Meet the challenge. God wants your young men and young women to rise up and give their lives as living sacrifices. God needs your money, your businesses, your homes, your lives to be dedicated to Him. God is depending upon you. I know that you will do it. I know that you are well able to do it." That was 41 years ago. 41 years ago. A man from Korea visiting, and that's what the Lord spoke to him. I find it interesting that phrase, "God is depending on you." I believe it's Larry Randolph who said this statement, which is, "God is obligated to fulfill His promises, but He is not obligated to fulfill your potential." I like that. He cannot lie. Yeah, if He promises something, it's sure to happen. But He's not obligated to fulfill your potential. There's something about us taking ownership of our lives, partnering with Him. It's not a works thing. It's not a striving. It's not that we strive and you don't. I'm not saying you have to pray more or read your Bible more and God will make your promises happen. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that there's something about us really giving our all and really choosing to partner with Him in it. And God has called us. You know, any word about Canada, we can claim for us. We are Canadians, right? Right? when Yonggi Cho was back in Canada 9 years later in 1984 in Sackville, Nova Scotia, the Lord gave him the same word, actually. Pretty much the exact same word. And he said, this is Yonggi Cho speaking. He said he hesitated to share the word. Because in his eyes, America was so powerful. And it seemed way more likely that God would do something through America. And so he asked the Lord, "Lord, are you sure it's Canada? Are you sure it's Canada?" And again, the Lord said, "Yes. Yes, it is Canada. That word is for Canada." And I just, I don't know, that just gets me excited. It just gets me excited that God is actually, He is actually releasing and pouring something out in our country that is setting us up for the end times, the last day's revival. And whatever that means and whatever that looks like, I just want to be a part of it. I want to read one more thing to you here. I'm just going to see if I can pull it up. This is from someone that we're all familiar with, a man named Jiva Sam. He looks a bit like me, if you're in. Or I look like him, yeah, probably that, yeah. This is a word my dad had for Canada a year ago, but he just re-released it, and there's just been a neat kind of breath of God on it. I'm just taking just an excerpt of it. "Do not be discouraged by what you read and see and hear in the news. Do not be disheartened by what the politicians are doing or not doing. Do not be dismayed by what is happening or not happening in your church or another one down the road. Remember where you are actually positioned. You are citizens of heaven, though you hold earthly passports. You may be standing on Canadian soil, but you are seated with me in the heavenly realms. I see the enemy sowing discord, trying to tear marriages apart, causing offense to take root among my people and their leaders, but you are not unaware of his schemes. Remember, your struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, authorities, and against powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Give up your offense against one another and go on the offensive against the enemy of your souls together. Call his bluff, take care of the stuff, nip his plans in the bud. Let your minds be renewed and your hearts healed up. Give him no room to get his foot in the door. Close the doors shut. Seal up the cracks. Stop stepping on each other's toes. Stomp your heels on the enemy's head together instead." Why don't we stand? And I'll call the worship team back up. You know, this morning I just want to invite you to join me, just in this pursuit of God. I know it's what we do week in and week out anyway, but I hope you can hear. Yeah, there's something in the air. There's some sense of urgency. Something is brewing in the heart of God, and I don't want to miss out on it, and I don't want any of us to miss out on it. For some of you tonight, this morning rather. It might be as simple as just a rededication of your life. God, I give you my life again. I prayed that prayer so many times, and I prayed again and again. God, I give you everything, all the things I try to hold on to and try to take control of. I'm giving them back to you. For some of you, I feel like there are promises. There are promises that you're like, God, where was that promise? Maybe you had promises for the summer or promises for last year. But I just want to encourage you, the kingdom of God, it is at hand. It is within reach. And we are all part of this. That word that my dad gave, I love, because it is together. That together we are stomping the head of the enemy. Together we are doing this. So we're going to take a couple minutes. I want to invite you just to listen from God. Ask the Lord, Lord, what do you want from me this morning? What does it look like for me to realign, to refocus my vision, and to really seek your face, to humble myself and seek your face. And we'll just kind of see where the Holy Spirit leads us. Father, we turn our eyes to you. Lord, we thank you that you have good plans for us. Lord, we thank you for the promises. Lord, we thank you for the words that were spoken 240 years ago about our land, that they ring true today. Why don't you just repeat this after me? Lord, thank you that I am a part of the last days. That I am a part of the end time army. Lord, today I surrender. Today I give it all to you. Lord, what does that look like? I want you to just listen. Lord, what does it look like for us to humble ourselves and to seek your face? Some of you, I feel like the Lord is asking you to give things up in your life. Just little habits here and there. Little things that maybe have just gone a little bit too far. Like the little foxes sometimes is an expression to describe the distractions, the things that try to take our eyes off. If he's asking you to give it up, then give it up, whatever that looks like this morning. Some of you, the Lord is asking you to be bold. He is releasing a new level of boldness on you. That place you've stepped into year after year just wondering, oh God, I know you want to do something here. I know you want to do something, or maybe that urge you feel to pray for your coworkers. Lord, I ask that you just release a boldness. A boldness that is no longer waiting, Lord, but that is active. That is active in partnering with you and seeing your plans unfold in this area. And I also want to encourage you this morning, both scriptures I read from in Chronicles and in Mark, they said repent. There was an element of repentance. If there's anything in your life like you feel like you need to repent of, it is not, there's no condemnation. If there's something you need to repent of this morning, the Lord is inviting you with all the compassion in the world to change your ways, to change your thinking, and to enter into something that is better. It is not about how bad it was. It is about how good it can be when you turn away from that thing. And so if it's come to mind, if you feel that impression on your heart, I want to invite you, give it before him this morning. God, we declare to you this morning as a community, God, as a body, that we will seek your face. Lord, that we will humble ourselves and seek you. God, I don't want 90% of what you have for me. I want it all. I want the 10% that I didn't even know was there. So we fix our eyes on you, God. We fix our eyes on you. Amen. I want to encourage you, as the worship team leads us in another song, you can continue this moment. If there's things he's speaking to you about, things on your heart. I even saw a picture of people coming up to the front this morning as well. So if you feel like you need to do that and do business with God, then do it, and let's just continue to seek him.
Is the power that lives in us. Our God is strong in us.